Hello there, guys, and welcome back to, well, not exactly a regular episodes of PVZ Garden Warfare, but so here's the deal. I was planning on setting up my Twitch account, and I was kind of tweaking around with the video settings and the video resolutions and stuff like that. So I played a quick game on Twitch, and wouldn't you know it, a couple of guys popped right in and they started talking to me and they started asking questions. And one of the guys, J-Meister, if I'm not mistaken, he asked if I could run through all of the available characters. Now, I did so for the plant side, so basically what I did on Twitch is I went to all of these different pea shooters, jumpers, sunflowers, and cactus and stuff. But eventually, by the end of the stream, I originally only intended to play a single game, but I ended up streaming for 2 hours, and well, it got a little bit too long for me. So I promised those guys that I would put up a YouTube video and showing off all the different foot soldiers characters. So, that being said, let's get right on it. Now, the bread and butter of the zombies usually in a team are the foot soldiers. Why? Because the foot soldiers are the range fighters in the game. I just checked to see if my mic was on. Yeah, the foot soldiers are the ranged fighters in the game. They're kind of the opposite of the cactus, but not as powerful as the cactus. Because the cactus, although he is a bit slower and not as mobile as the foot soldier is still able to do a decent amount of damage in a ranged fight. The foot soldier has the following abilities: the rocket leap. Let's look at the rocket jump. Let's look at the tutorial. Which is kind of similar to the hyper mode of the pea shooter. What you basically can do with this is jump up on the buildings and get onto the high ground and try sniping the enemy from above. When used correctly, it can be very effective, and if you can get up in good sniping spots, also very handy to have. What I usually use it for is to jump out of a dangerous area. Let's say I'm capturing the garden and I see a bean bomb being deployed right in front of me. I like to use it to jump out of the way and get the fudge out of there. Next up is the ZPG. I guess that stands for zombie propelled grenade or something like that, I don't know. Well, RPG stands for rocket propelled grenade. Yeah, I think it was grenade. Anyway, let's look at the tutorial. Yeah, so basically the ZPG is a one-time deal kind of missile that you launch at the enemy. It does a lot of damage, and if I'm not mistaken, it can take out any plant on a direct hit, even an armored chomper, which has 225 health points. So yeah, if you can get a hit off, it does a great amount of damage. It also has a blast radius, so if you can aim your CPG at a group of plants, chances are you'll kill multiple of them. Next up is the zombie stink cloud. The zombie stink cloud, it's kind of like a, well, look, let's look at the animation. There we go. It not only blinds the enemy, but it also does some damage. Not a lot of damage, mind you, but still. What's a good way to use the zombie stink cloud? From a purely offensive perspective, you might say that the ideally, first up you would shoot your ZPG at the unsuspecting group of plants. And if you've taken down a couple of them and damaged the rest of them, you might want to start running towards the garden and shoot everything you can. And when you're close enough to throw your smoke grenade, it's kind of like a grenade toss. So when you're close enough to throw your zombie stink clouds at them, drop it in them and it'll take and they'll take damage and they'll even be able to blind them. From a defensive point of view, you might want to deploy your... There are two ways to use this defensively, I think. One is to throw it into the garden and hide within the smoke. It's risky because, well, chances are if the plants know you're in there, they can just lob a chili bean into the smoke and you'll die anyway. But I rather use this to blind the enemy when I'm capturing the garden, because there are certain points on the map that are very good defensive positions for the plants. So when I'm into a garden and I'll know that the plants will be hiding somewhere from a sniping position, I like to throw my zombie stink cloud somewhere either between them or on top of that position, just so that I can blind them and force them out of their hiding spot. So these are the basic three abilities that the foot soldier has. There are a couple of variants, but I'm not gonna show them off to you guys because, well, like I said in the live stream, I don't want to spoil it all, so that's that. Now the basic foot soldier does have a regular line of fire. And like I've already said in the stream, I really like the classic characters a lot. You'll just have to play around with him. He's really fun to play with. Now, let's have a look at the different variants. Now, this guy, we refer to him as the crossbow guy, but his actual name is a super commando. In a lot of opinions, this guy is the most OP character in the game. Why? Because if you have a look at his crossbow, you can see all these pellets that are loaded into the crossbow. They all fire in one shot. So basically you get three shots in one firing action. And they all do like 13 damage or something like that. So if you get a full hit, you'll be able to do 39 damage or something like that, which is a lot of damage. And it also means... And he also has the advantage of a very fast reload time. So, he fires very fast. He's able to do a lot of damage. And that's why most people think that he is pretty OP. Now, here's the deal with this guy. He needs to be accurate. Because not all of his three shots might hit you. For example, one of those pellets might hit you, but the two other might miss. So you need to be very accurate with this guy. It depends on what kind of team you're in, and it depends on what kind of team the zombies are in. But let's say you've noticed that on the opposite side you have 5 or 6 players all playing as a foot soldier or as a super commando. Then you know that you need to be a fast character on the plant side. So you don't want to be a chomper, because the chompers are usually slow. And well, chances are, if you play as a chomper, you're gonna get your butt whooped. He has the same abilities as the other foot soldier, so I don't need to talk about that all that much. So yeah. Quite possibly the most OP character in the game. Still, if you use a little common sense and if you're smart about what plant you choose, you can put up a decent defense against these guys. Next up is the Arctic Trooper. The Arctic Trooper has the ability to do freezing damage or frost damage, and somewhat similar to the ice pea or the frost pea and the ice cactus. If you can get enough shots on the enemy with this, I don't know what it's called. This gun is called the Frozen Z1 Assault Blaster. If you can get enough shots on the enemy, you might be able to freeze them in their place and kill them however you like. It's fun to play with multiple freezing zombies on your team, because then the chances of freezing the enemy in their place is bigger. And if I'm not mistaken, a while ago there was a challenge that we should do as much freezing damage as possible, and it was fun because if you can freeze the enemy in their place, it's really fun to do. So that's the Arctic Trooper, and next up we have the Tank Commander. Now the Tank Commander is tricky. He has a slow firing rate, but he fires a single missile or cannon. And that cannon, if you get a direct hit at close range, you're able to do 70 damage, if I'm not mistaken. And the cannonball or the explosives that he fires does have a blast radius, so you can do some blast damage. So ideally, if you're standing up top somewhere and you can shoot the plants from up top, you'll be able to do more damage. But for me personally, I've said it numerous times again before, my aiming kinda sucks, especially when I get up close and personal, like when I'm heading into the garden. I get all excited and I usually miss a lot of my shots. And because of this guy's slow firing rate, well, I'm not that good playing as the Tank Commander. Otherwise, he is pretty handy to have if you want to play as a supporting character. If you tend to hide in the sniping positions, if you can do that and your aiming is really good, you'll have a fun time playing as the Tank Commander. Next up, General Supremo. Now, Il General is His firing ability is that he has an unlimited amount of ammo. So basically, you can keep firing and you don't need to reload, but it doesn't mean that you can fire non-stop, because at a certain point of time your weapon will overheat and it will need to cool down a bit, so you won't be able to fight continuously. You need to stop every now and then and reacquire your target. So basically, if you can, I've seen a lot of players also play as the General Supremo, because, well, that ability he has of having unlimited ammo. Pretty deadly if used correctly. You should be aware that his aiming while firing, the gun keeps pulling a little bit to the right or to the left, I'm not quite sure anymore. So you have to constantly adjust your aiming. It's not like the aiming is fixed, unless you use some kind of aimbot, but never mind that. Next up is the Camo Ranger. The Camo Ranger is sort of like the counterpart to the Camo Cactus. As I said on the live stream, the Camo Cactus is quite possibly the most devastating cactus there is, because he has his zooming abilities are amazing. The Camo Cactus also has a zoom in ability, not as great as the Camo Cactus, but what he has going for him is a faster firing rate. His damage isn't as good as that of the Camo Cactus, but he is able to fire multiple shots, and compared to the Camo Cactus, who can only fire, who has a very slow firing rate, well, you have to pick your battles. Like I said, the cacti are the ranged fighters of the game, and it is not wise to face them in a ranged battle, on a one-on-one ranged battle. Chances are they'll take you out, unless you have a lot of other range fighters on your team and you have some backup, I do not suggest, if you're a camo ranger and you're facing a camo cactus, I wouldn't suggest you taking the camo cactus on in a one-on-one battle. Next up, the Sky Trooper. Now, the Sky Trooper is an interesting one to play as. This guy has an incredibly fast firing rate. He can unleash, I don't know how many, maybe 30 or 40 bullets in a very fast amount of time, in a very short amount of time, and his damage can be devastating. If you manage to hit your enemy with your entire clip, I'll be sure you'll be able to kill the enemy quite fast. But because he fires his round so fast, he needs to reload again and again. So you need to be careful how you play this guy. Plus, his damage in a ranged fight isn't as great as. Whoa. You do more damage when you get up close to the enemy, so it's a kind of a trade-off. I do like playing with this guy because, like I said, I like to head into the garden and try to capture their base. So this guy usually does work for me, but I'd much rather play with a classic foot soldier because I'm more used to playing with that guy. Next up, the Centurion. The Centurion was introduced in the latest Legends of the Lawn pack. He shoots fire bouquets or something like that. Flame bolts, oh, okay. Basically, he is a foot soldier who does fire damage. His fire rate isn't that great, but the fire damage that he can cause is helpful. It's good for harassing the enemy. If you can shoot multiple enemies at once and send them all burning, it's good to harass the enemy. He doesn't do a spectacular amount of damage on the shot itself, but once again, it depends on your team. If you have a very aggressive team, players with lots of engineers and lots of all-stars who are all heading towards the garden and you don't need to head into the garden yourself, this guy can be an interesting choice. To set the enemy on fire is interesting enough. And well, here's another little tactic that I find annoying. When somebody sets you on fire, it kind of messes up your ability to aim. Why? Because your reticle, the thing you're using to aim with, the little cross in the middle of the screen, it's kind of hard to see because all the flames and fire that when you're on fire, the flames kind of mess up your aiming ability. It's hard to see the little reticle. So that might be another good thing for using this guy. And I think we've got all the foot soldiers. Alright. Next up is, in my opinion, the most important character in the Zombies game. The Engineer. Now, the Engineer has... well, let's just look at his abilities first. Like the Cactus, who has his Garlic Drone or the Artichoke Drone. So does the Zombies have the Zomba Drone. Yeah, use the Zomba Drone at your own discretion. I mean, they can be very devastating. If I usually like to use them if there are a lot of cacti on the opposing team who's played smart. They deploy all their mines in the garden and, well, If you're a foot soldier and you have to take out all those mines, you have to shoot them one by one by one. It'll take a lot of time and you'll give away your position, and chances are you'll be shot before you can even destroy four mines. So, using the Samba drone and deploying your, what kind of strike? Was it a cone strike? Zed can also can attack plants from above and call in devastating cone strike. Oh, okay, it is a cone strike. So using the cone strike, it can clear the entire garden of any plants, and especially all the spike weeds and the potato mines that the plants would have left there. So, it's good to have. Next up is the jackhammer. Now the jackhammer is a very interesting ability to have. Not only does it give you a speed boost, you'll be able to drive faster than walking. Secondly, you'll be able to jump higher. So let's say there's a certain wall you wouldn't be able to jump over normally. With a jackhammer, you would be able to jump over that wall. But what I like to use the jackhammer for is to unroot plants. For example, the sunflower, who can do the solar flare attack, where he burrows into the ground a bit and he shoots those pew pew laser beams. You are able to unroot those plants when using the jackhammer. All you need to do is drive up to them and bump into them with your jackhammer, and they'll unroot. So that's why I like using this jackhammer ability when I see a lot of plants and plant sunflowers and pea shooters who have rooted themselves in the ground and doing damage to your teammates. If you can rush in there with your jackhammer and unroot them all, well, you'll save your teammate a lot of trouble. And not only can you bump into the rooted plants, you can just bump into all of the other plants and they'll take a little amount of damage as well. And this works on chompers as well. Mind you, the chompers, when they burrow into the ground, it takes a second or two before they're completely burrowed on the ground. When they're completely burrowed on the ground, they're practically, they are impervious to any damage you can do to them. But during the second it takes for them to burrow, you can bump into this and bump into them with a jackhammer, and it'll prevent them from burrowing down. And chances are you'll be able to shoot them while riding the jackhammer and destroy them, because quite frankly they're quite helpless then. Next up, the sonic grenade. Now the sonic grenade, or the variety ability, the sonic mine, the proximity sonic mine, is, in my opinion, well, let's just talk about the advantages it has. It is the only way to force a burrow chomper up from underground. So, if the enemy team has a lot of chompers on their side, you need to change character. You need to play as the engineer. I know it's scary facing off a buttload of chompers, but it's the only way. Otherwise, everybody will hide in the back and try to shoot the chompers from way in the back, and nobody will head into the garden. And that's not how you win the game. So, change into an engineer. Run in there with your jackhammer. Take care of any plants you see. Dismount and start deploying your sonic mines or throw your sonic grenades. It doesn't matter. Force those chompers up. And chances are you'll have some backup, hopefully, from foot soldiers standing in the back, and they can shoot them from behind. Now, in gardens and graveyards, there is one other ability. Well, Yeah, one other ability that the engineer has, and that is putting up the teleporter. The teleporter will allow your team to, well, as the name says, teleport. So you don't have to run all the way from way in the back from where you spawn all the way up to the front. The teleporter is usually placed somewhere halfway up there, up to the objective. So, yeah. And it's especially helpful when you have a lot of all-stars on your team, because all-stars are slow. So if you have a lot of slow characters on your team, you definitely need a teleporter, so you definitely need an engineer. Now here's a mistake I've seen all too often, is that a lot of new players think, hey, the all-star looks awesome, let's all play as an all-star. Which can be an effective tactic, but because they're so slow, if the enemy is any good, if the plants are any good, they'll change into a lot of cacti and just take out your all-stars before they can even reach the garden. So, if you see that you guys, the zombies, aren't able to push forward past the halfway point, or if you're unable to get into the garden, play as the engineer. Put up the teleporter, help out your friends, help out your teammates so they don't have to walk all the way from the back. And, it really helps them out. Now, by far, the engineer is my most favorite character to play as. Why? Because he is very essential to the team, and he can, like I said, I like to get up close and do a lot of damage to the enemy when I'm really already capturing in the garden. Now, most engineers do a lot of splash damage, so that's also very helpful when you're fighting inside the garden, because you can clean out a lot of plants. Now, the engineer is also pretty effective when playing against a team of which are comprised of a lot of sunflowers. Now, sunflowers are a pain in the butt because they can revive one another and they can heal one another. So basically, if you just manage to take out one sunflower, chances are his teammates, his buddies will revive him and heal him right back up, and your kill would count for nothing. Now, it's a mistake I've seen made by many of the zombies when they face a team full of sunflowers, that everybody just wants to play as a foot soldier and they'll shoot them one by one from the back, but the sunflowers will just keep on reviving one another and eventually the zombies will lose. So, playing as an engineer, what you can do is you can rush right in and start firing at all those little sunflowers who are bunched up together. Why? Because the engineer has splash damage, and he does a decent amount of splash damage. The 4 shots, maybe 5 with the splash damage he does, can kill most sunflowers. So, that's why I think the engineer is my all-time favorite and one of the most essential players in the game. And to my surprise, not a lot of players know, well, not a lot of new players actually play as the engineer. They all want to play as the foot soldier because, yeah, you can play a ranged game, you're fairly safe hiding in the back, but that's not how you win the game. You need to get into the garden. Anyway, that's enough about me waxing poetic about the engineer. Let's have a look at the different varieties of engineers. Next, well, okay, let's talk about the welder first. If I'm not mistaken, the welder is the last engineer that you will be able to unlock. Yeah, that's basically it. What makes the engineers kind of difficult to play as is their shots, because most of their shots are subjected to gravity, so they arc. So basically, you have to aim above the target, so it arcs down, and you need to be able to time it and aim fairly accurate with most of the engineers. There are a few exceptions, like the mechanic, but most of the engineers, you need to get the aiming right. You need to aim a little bit above the enemy if they're quite a distance away. Now the welder does fire damage, and basically what he is able to do is, I don't know what he fires actually, maybe gas tanks or something like that, little oxygen tanks, and when they hit the target they do fire damage, and well, we all know what fire damage does to the enemy. For a while he was my favorite engineer to play as. Why? Because he has a decent range on him, because some of the engineers, their shots are only good for short to medium range battles, but this guy can fire at long range as well. So if you like sniping a bit, you might want to think about playing this guy. Next up, the electrician. Now the electrician is the guy who, well, when you talk about splash damage, this guy really embodies his splash damage. The range on his electrical, what do you call it, photo blasters, his shots, is incredible. And once again, this guy is exceptional at taking out a bunch of sunflowers who are all bunched up together. Fire 5 or 6 shots with your photo blaster and you'll be able to clear out an entire garden. Electrical damage, as I said in the live stream, it chains and does damage to the enemy next to the one you're firing at, and so on and so on. So basically, splash damage. Yes, I like. Next up is the mechanic. Now the mechanic is an interesting one. He basically shoots lug nuts and other kinds of screws and stuff like that, but his shots don't arc. Like the other engineers, this guy's shots fires in a straight line. He has an interesting character to play, and I usually play this character if I'm facing a lot of cacti who use their drones. Why? Because shooting the drones out of the sky is quite troublesome if you're trying to do it as an electrician, because his shots make a weird arc, and so does the welders, and so does the regular engineer. So the mechanic, who has a very fast firing rate, is able to shoot those drones out of the air because he fires very rapidly, and he is able to destroy those drones. Unfortunately, he doesn't have any splash damage, so he's not that good for rushing into the garden. But still, it depends on the type of enemy you're facing, and well, try to adjust accordingly. Next up, the painter. Now the painter is the sniper class in the engineer. He has a very slow firing rate, but if you manage to hit an enemy, you'll be able to do 40 damage, and his shots also does a little bit of splash damage, 15 if I'm not mistaken. So yeah, if you want to snipe, use this guy. Doesn't really suit my playing style, but hey, it's fun sometimes to snipe a bit as an engineer, especially when you have a very aggressive team of all-stars or foot soldiers or whatever, or scientists. If your teammates are reliable, you can definitely use this character to start sniping from the back. Next up is my all-time favorite character by far in the game, the plumber. This is my go-to guy. I've based my avatar, my profile picture, on this guy. Why? Because I love him that much. This is Bob, ladies and gentlemen. Now, what makes Bob so special? Well, Bob does a lot of splash damage. His regular shot, if you're able to get a hit on the enemy, it does about 40 damage. But his splash damage is 25, which is a lot. And that's why I love this guy, for rushing into the garden and start killing everything I see. I've basically described my playing style already, but if I manage to get a teleporter, I start heading for the garden. When I'm in the garden, when I'm near the garden, I pull out my jackhammer and start driving and firing as fast as I can into the garden. Because, first of all, I want to clear the garden of all the spikeweeds and the potato mines. If there are any spikeweeds and potato mines in there, my splash damage, my plunge shot, can take them out. 25 damage is more than enough to take down the spikeweeds and the potato mines. And if I've cleared that, hopefully I've done a lot of damage to the plants that are also in there. If not, I'll keep on firing on the plants and hopefully I'll kill them all. If I manage to survive that and I dismount from my jackhammer, I start deploying my sonic mines. Now, some people like to deploy all the sonic mines at once. I like to do it kind of sparingly. I like to deploy one, and when that one goes off, it'll stun most of the plants in the vicinity, and I can take them out one by one, hopefully multiple at a time. Why? Because once again, my splash damage is able to kill multiple plants in a go. So hopefully, if I play it correctly, I will be able to survive the garden attack. And that's why, as a solo player, I like this guy a lot, because he can clean out a garden on his own. Mind you, at the end of, if he survives, you won't have a lot of health, and that's where your teammates are crucial. Hopefully, there'll be all-stars in there with you then, and even better, a scientist who can heal you back up. Now, the way I play this guy, I usually don't use my drone all that much. Why? Because I much rather have my body in the garden, which counts as, as a body in the garden. You can only win if you're capping. So that's why I don't really like to use my drone all that much, because, it doesn't really help all that much in my opinion. You can use it to harass the enemy, but I much rather be in the garden itself. So, Bob the Plumber, my all-time favorite.
I love you, buddy!
You're like my brother from another mother. Well, a dead mother. A zombie mother. Alright, enough goofing around. Next up, the Landscaper. Alright, I always confuse these two, the Landscaper and the Sanitation Expert, but I think the Landscaper, well, let's just talk about his abilities. The Landscaper does toxic damage, like the Toxic Pea, like the Toxic Chomper. The Landscaper does toxic damage as well. He has a very fast firing rate, but I find his aim, it's a bit inaccurate. He has a automatic firing rate, so you just have to keep pushing your left mouse button and he'll just keep firing until you run out of ammo and you need to reload. Once again, he shoots toxic damage and it does a decent amount of damage as well, but you need to aim, and I usually lose a bit of concentration while aiming because he has an automatic firing rate. So all you have to do is keep your mouse button pushed in and he'll just keep pelting those toxic, those weed buster things at the plants. If you are very good at aiming, if you're very accurate, sure, you might want to play as this guy. The downside of playing as this guy is his range isn't that great. Like most of the engineers, their range aren't that great. But if you can get close enough and you manage to land a couple of hits on the enemy, chances are you'll be able to take him out. Pretty interesting character to play as. But once again, you need to be able to aim him very well, and his reload speed is not that great, unfortunately. Next up is the Sanitation Expert. Now, the Sanitation Expert is kind of similar to the Landscaper because he also does toxic damage. But he has a greater range and he doesn't have the automatic firing rate. He just has a semi-automatic. You need to click, 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 click to fire 3 shots, for example. He has a greater range and he's a bit more accurate. And, well, that's why, I like playing as him. I don't have a very strong opinion on both of them either way. Both have their good sides and both have their pros and cons, of course, but you need to figure it out for yourself. They both do splash damage, of course. It's not great, but it is toxic damage, and like all toxic damage, it's a lasting damage, a lasting effect, so you'll be able to do some extra damage if the enemy runs away from you. You'll still be able to do some damage. So those are the engineers. Next up, the scientist. Here we go. Load in already. Let's look at you. Now the scientist are the medics on the zombie side. Let's have a look at their abilities. Now these are the regular abilities you'll be able to unlock first. Let's have a look at warp. Yeah, so that's the warp ability. You use the warp ability to get to places very fast. So let's say you're running down the field or down the garden and you see a lot of cactus facing you, and you know that you're not fast enough to outrun these cacti because they kept shooting at you. You really want to use your warping ability. You'll be able to teleport up to the front very fast, and hopefully you'll be in range to the cactus and you can shoot them from up close. Why? Because most scientists do an insane amount of damage when they get up close. I'll show you the different types of scientists in a second, and I'll explain each type of weapon they wield. But keep that in mind, they do an insane amount of damage up close. Next up is the zombie heal station. The zombie heal station is kind of like the heal flower that the sunflower has. Let's have a look. Now if your teammates are hurt, you can place down your heal station and it'll heal each and every zombie that's near the heal station. What can I say about the heal station? There are a few different types of heal stations. Let me give this one away. Next up, you'll be able to unlock the armored heal station. The armored heal station is a lot sturdier because the plants can shoot at your heal station and destroy it if they want to. And usually, if I see a healing station with lots of zombies healing around it, I'm tempted to shoot a bean bomb in there and, kill them all. So your healing station will be destroyed as well, and you will not be able to use that well again. The armored heal station will be able to survive a bean bomb up close, but I never ever use the armored heal station. Why? Because it takes way too long to heal the zombies. Now these different healing stations have a different rate at healing the zombies. This is the regular healing station, which heals you relatively fast, but the armored heal station is slow. It's so slow. And I definitely don't want to use it. Let's say you've just captured a garden and you need to be rushing for the next garden and you see one of these armored heal stations around. It'll take forever to heal back up. You'll lose at least another 30 seconds of the clock just to heal up. And it is time. And you need that time to head for the garden to take out the enemies. So keep pushing, ignore the armored heal station. It's a really bad addition to the game, so don't use it. That's my advice. Now, by far the best heal station is the Cheetah heal station, which was introduced in the Cheetos promotional thingy. And it has the fastest healing rate of all the healing stations. I love this thing, and I hope we'll have something equivalent to this in Garden Warfare 2. I don't know, because as I've mentioned in the live stream, all the promotional characters will not be returning in Garden Warfare 2. So I kind of hope that the healing station will... Wait a minute. I think, according to the teasers that I saw online at GamesCon and at E3 and stuff like that, the healing ability of the scientist will have changed. In the videos, he has a similar ability to the heal beam as the sunflower. I'm not quite sure if that's a definite thing, but anyway, heal stations might not make an appearance at all. We'll just have to wait and see. The next ability that the scientist has is the sticky ball. Now, the sticky ball, says the name, sticky explodey ball. Well, the name says it all. You can throw these little grenades and they stick to do whatever you throw it on. If you throw it onto a character, it'll stick to that character. If you throw it on a plant, it'll stick to the plant. If you throw it on a wall, it'll stick to the wall. If you throw it on the floor, and so on and so forth. Now, these guys are pretty handy to have. You can use them as little grenades when you're... when you're going to the garden, you can throw these grenades in there. And they'll just stick to the floor, waiting for a plant to come near it, and it'll explode when a plant is near it. Otherwise, it'll just stick there and not do anything. It's kind of like a proximity grenade. And the fun thing about these sticky explodey balls is I don't think you can destroy them as a plant. Somebody has to detonate them, but luckily they don't stick around for a very long time. I never really timed it, but maybe they stick around for 10 to 20 seconds, and then if nobody set it off, it'll just despawn. A good tactic to use them is when you're being chased by a plant. And you run around the corner, try throwing these down on the wall next to the garden, next to the corner. And then when he turns the corner, he'll just set them off. So, nice little grenades to have. Anyway, let's have a look at the different types of scientists. First up, the marine biologist. Now, back in the day, the marine biologist was so OP. Now, like most scientists, you need to get really close to the enemy. And then when you get close, he does devastating amount of damage. And you do it kind of in a spray-like way, so you won't just be able, so you won't just shoot the person in front of you. Chances are, if there are three zombies all standing next to each other, all standing in front of you, you'll be able to hit all three of them when playing as a scientist. And likewise for the marine biologist, I really like playing as this guy. This is another character to play as when you're facing a lot of sunflowers. When the sunflowers are in the garden, you can counter them by playing as this guy. If you have a lot of engineers on the team and you manage to get into the garden, you can clear out the garden just like that and deploy your healing station, and you're ready for battle. throw down a couple of your sticky explodey balls near the entrances where you know the plants will be coming from, and you'll be able to damage them before they even reach the garden. So, definitely fierce to behold. If you get up close to the enemy, you can be absolutely dominating the game. But once again, be careful of cacti, be careful of pea shooters who can take you out from a distance. Since you are the medic, just like the sunflower, you are kind of squidgy and puny. You don't have a lot of health points, so you can die very easily, so we have to take that into account. Don't try to face the enemy head on, try to flank them a bit and use your warping ability to sneak around a bit. What I like to do with these guys is I like to head into the enemy defenses. So let's say the plants are all hiding behind the garden up on a building. I like to get in on top of that building as well and kill the enemy from behind. If I survive, I'll deploy my healing station and I'll be ready for battle. So, that's basically the marine biologist. Next up, Dr. Toxic. Now, to be quite honest, Dr. Toxic is a ranged fighter, and as the name implies, he does toxic damage, which is good. He doesn't have the spraying ability as like the marine biologist, so what you basically get is a one-on-one battle. You can shoot one other target, and yes, the toxic damage will damage the nearby plants as well, but it's not a lot of damage. So if you like doing toxic damage, once again, if your team is doing, if your teammates are playing aggressively enough, if they're capturing the garden, you can use this as a supporting character to harass the enemy from the back, kind of like the Centurion. Next up, the physicist, also kind of similar to the Dr. Toxic, but instead of toxic damage, this guy does electrical damage. Up close, well, the closer you get, of course, the more damage your shots will do. And this guy does a decent amount of damage as well, if I'm not mistaken. Once again, he is a kind of a one-on-one kind of guy. Yes, his electrical damage will chain to the next plant. So also an interesting character to play as, but the firing rate isn't that great, so you really need to time it well. Kind of use him like a guerrilla warrior. You need to attack and retreat, attack and retreat. And that's basically all of the scientists summed up in a nutshell. Described in a nutshell, because, well, they're so squidgy. So you need to get in there, kill as many things as possible. And if you're still alive and there are still plants nearby, get out of range, hide and heal up, and then get back in there. Next up, the astronaut. Now, the astronaut, if you're an experienced player, the astronaut is quite devastating. I've never been able to really master this character, but he has an incredible fast firing rate and he does a decent amount of damage, and you can fight with him from a distance. So if you have a lot of plants that, especially cactuses, who like to stand still and aim from a distance, you can take them out because this guy has a very fast firing rate. But even up close, if you are accurate and your aiming doesn't suck like mine, you are still able to put up a decent fight. So I've seen a lot of experienced players play as this guy. I really wish I was as good at them at playing this guy as they are, but unfortunately, I suck. Next up, the chemist. Now, the chemist is my type of guy. Because this guy, well, him, you know, I mentioned that spraying ability that he manages to damage everything in front of him. This guy is definitely the master of destroying everything that's in front of him. But you really need to be very close. You if he isn't within, I don't know, 5 steps of you, you won't be able to damage him, so you need to be really close to the enemy. Which is good if you're facing a team of sunflowers or even chompers. If you can manage to sneak up on a chomper, which I always like to do as a scientist, and just unleash your entire clip into a horde of plants, you'll be able to take them out very quickly. Once again, he won't be able to damage anything outside of that, I don't know, 5-step range. So, you need to be very careful when playing this guy. Don't get caught at a distance. You need to really get in close to the enemy. Next up, the archaeologist. I don't know. I have not played with this character a lot. And I have no advice to give, quite honestly, about him. He shoots a lot of coins, if I'm not mistaken, and treasure. You see a lot of treasure on his back. So basically, he shoots treasure at you, but it's not very damaging, and I don't know. Maybe I should play with him more, but quite honestly, I don't feel like it. Next up, Dr. Chester. Dr. Chester is like... what's his name? The Chester or Chomper, whatever. Cheetos Chomper, whatever. This guy was introduced during the Cheetos campaign. He has an incredible firing rate. So, yeah. He is fun to play as, but once again, this character will not be making an appearance in Garden Warfare 2. So if you have him, play him while you can. He is quite fun to play as. Now, this guy, if my computer won't be so sucky, the paleontologist, is the latest scientist that was introduced in the Legends of the Lawn pack. This guy is... I don't know. I love him and I hate him as well. Why? Because he does fire damage. You see those little volcanoes on those triple T-Rex gun of his? So basically what he does is fires a beam of... I don't know. What is this? Dino upgrade, dino speed, dino tail, dino... I don't know. Anyway, he does fire damage. His fire rate is pretty decent as well. So if you can harass the enemy from the back... because his fire beam is a ranged attack, you can do up to 16 damage from a distance. The closer you get, the more damage you'll be able to do. And his shots do have a little bit of splash damage as well, which is good because, well, even if the enemy just takes the splash damage, they'll be set on fire and they'll also take the burning damage, like all fire damage does in the game. So I love that ability of him, but it also means that, well, if you have a lot of people just playing as this guy, chances are that most of them will be fighting from the back. But it can be a very devastating combo if you have a lot of paleontologists on the team, on the enemy team. So yeah, fun to play as, but you really need to... know how to master him. And those are the scientists. I'm going to take a short break. I'll be right back, guys. And we're back, guys. Okay, now next up are the All-Stars. Now the All-Stars are the powerhouses of the team. They have a very large amount of health, but they are very slow. So, what does that mean gameplay wise? If you have a team with a lot of scientists on the team, it might make for an interesting combination because the scientists might be able to revive these guys and heal them back up. But Because they're so slow, you need to be very careful because chances are the speedy little pea shooters will just keep pushing forward and start shooting at you guys, so it's a gamble playing as the All-Star. Now, a good combination to have is an engineer and the All-Star, because the All-Star can use a teleporter, so he doesn't have to walk all the way from the back up to the front. He can just use a teleporter and head straight for the garden. He has a lot of health, so if he manages to reach the garden, he has a very devastating impunt ability. Let's show it. There you go. The impunt is like a tiny little suicide bomber. And, well, he does a lot of damage. It can take out any plant that it is able to damage. So, if you can get close enough and you see a bunch of chompers just hiding behind a little wall, throw your little impunt in there, kick it in there, and see them all die. You can kill multiple plants with a single impunt, and it is truly beautiful when you're able to kill, I don't know, 5 or 6 plants with a single impunt. Just all those little ding 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 ding. That is still one of the most satisfying sounds in the game. Anyway, but let's have a look at his other abilities. Next up, the sprint tackle. There you go. The sprint tackle is, as the name implies, you'll be able to move a very fast. Well, you'll be able to sprint a very short distance, and you'll be doing a lot of damage to all the plants that stand in your way. What happens is that the plants will be pushed out of the way, so they'll fly back a bit. So if they're standing in the garden and you're able to sprint tackle them, chances are you blow them out of the garden and they'll either die or land back in the back of the garden. So it's a good way to clear out the garden. Well, let me just show you the next ability, the dummy shield. Now that's a dummy shield for you. Quite honestly, I'm not that big of a fan of the dummy shield. Why? Because, in my opinion, mostly dummies use the dummy shield. let me rephrase that. The dummy shield is, in my opinion, best used to block the plants from reaching the garden. So let's say there is a doorway where the plants can race through to get into the garden. If you can manage to block that doorway, that's a good use of the dummy shield to me. But most of the times, the dummies that are using them are just people running straight into the enemy, and they have no cover, so they put up this dummy shield and they'll hide behind it. Why would you do that? Yes, you'll maybe be able to live for 2 seconds longer, but 2 shots and the dummy shield will be destroyed and you'll still be a target for the plants. So no, don't use the dummy shield as a shield. Use it as an obstacle to prevent the plants from getting into the garden. Now, I usually don't like playing as the All-Star. Why? Because, like I said, he is slow. And for someone like me, where getting into the garden is the most important thing in the game, I usually die before I even reach the garden. Unless I have a backup from a good team of foot soldiers who can clear the sky and clear the rooftops, and unless I have an engineer on my team who has the teleporter up and running, I don't like playing as an All-Star. Because only if those conditions are met, you'll be able to get to the garden consistently and, well, clear it out. Because my tactic is, if I get close enough to the garden, I'll try to use my impunt to clear it out, to kill as many as I can. If there are still plants in there, I'll use my sprint tackle to well, to bump them out of there, to push them out of there, and then I'm going to start shooting anybody and everybody I see. Talking about the shooting ability, let's talk about the All-Stars weaponry. Like the General Supremo, they also have unlimited ammo. So basically what that means is you can keep holding down your left mouse button. If you keep pushing it, it'll keep firing your gun. But you need to be careful that your gun doesn't overheat, because when it does, you'll have to wait a little cooldown period. And you are quite vulnerable during those precious seconds. So, don't keep firing like an idiot. Stop every now and again, let your weapon cool down for a second or two, and then reopen fire. Now, I'm not very pleased with me playing as an all-star, but I've seen a lot of experienced players play as the regular all-star. Why? Because not only does the range on these guys, they're pretty good, these footballs also have a little blast radius, so he does have a little bit of splash damage. So this guy is a pretty decent all-star to play as. Anyway, next up, the Cricket Star. Now the Cricket Star is my favorite all-star to play as. He doesn't have that good of a ranged ability as the regular all-star, because his shots also arc. Sorry. But he does have a fire, he does do fire damage. And he has, as most all-stars, they have a very fast firing rate. So what you'll be able to do is, keep firing at the enemy. It does about, maybe 10 damage per hit. And in addition to the 10 damage of your shot itself, it'll do an additional 5 damage of fire over time. So if you keep hitting him, you keep setting the enemy on fire. And basically, if you're accurate enough, you can just kill most plants in a very short time. Now, because you're dealing with fire damage, in my opinion, you won't be able to fire as long as the regular all-star, because your weapon will overheat faster than this dude's, the regular all-star. So you need to be careful with that and keep an eye on the at how long you're firing at an enemy. Next up is the Goalie Star. The Goalie Star is the opposite of the Cricket Star, because this guy does frost damage, freezing damage. And because his weapon is already pretty cool and chill, you can fire for a really long time. It doesn't overheat as fast as the other weapons, as the other All-Star, so let her rip. Unfortunately, this weapon does not do any splash damage, so you need to be very accurate. But if you are accurate and you manage to hit the enemy a couple of times, they'll be frozen in place and you can just toy with the enemy then. Just keep pelting them until they're dead with all these hockey pucks. So, I used to play with this guy a lot as well. This is a fun guy to play as, but once again, you need to be very accurate, and that's my downfall. Next up is the Baseball Star. The Baseball Star! I know in my YouTube videos, one of you guys requested me to play as the Baseball Star. I don't know. He has a very fast firing rate, so if you're accurate enough, you can take down the enemy pretty fast. Doesn't do any splash damage, so yeah. Fast firing rate, decent amount of damage, but you need to be accurate, and well, that's just not me, unfortunately. Next up, the Hockey Star. Now, the Hockey Star shoots stinky gloves. And to be quite honest, I really don't like this guy. Because, I don't know. Let's just say I don't have a very strong opinion about the guy either way. His damage is okay. He does a bit of splash damage because it's stinky, but still, not my go-to all-star guy. You need to check him out yourselves. The rugby star is an interesting one. As you can see, they have the footballs that he shoots, or the rugby balls, footballs, whatever you wanna call it. They all have a little bit of dynamite at the end, so that's basically what you shoot at. Shooting at little explosive footballs. If I'm not mistaken, you should be... His shots also arc like the engineer, so you need to get the aiming right. Which is kind of tricky, so you really need to... be confident and know what you're doing when playing with this guy, otherwise you'll just miss a lot of shots. But splash damage and, well, fast firing rate, explosive damage, pretty awesome. Next up, the wrestling star. This is a character I haven't really played a lot as. Quite honestly, I don't know what to tell about him. If I'm not mistaken, he shoots action figures. I really don't play as this guy, so I can't really give you any advice on him. Play with him if you want. I'm just going to shut up about him. Now, the Golf Star is the latest All-Star that was released in the Legends of the Lawn pack. And his ability is the range that he has, because these little golf balls can practically shoot in a straight line. There is a slight arc in his shot, but not very much if I'm mistaken. And these golf balls are very fast. Those are almost instantaneous shots. No splash damage, but you have a very good range with him. So if the enemy is, I don't know, a cactus and he is not aware that you are taking aim at him, let her rip. Now, he doesn't do a lot of damage like most All-Stars. The one single hit won't do a lot of damage, but because of their fast firing rate, if you manage to pel in a lot of shots on the enemy, you can take him out pretty fast. The general mechanic still applies. If you get up close, you'll do more damage than just hiding in the back. But like I said, the All-Star has a lot of health, so you need to get into the garden to do the maximum amount of damage with all of your weapons. That's why it pisses me off to see All-Stars, well, players playing as the Golf Star, who has a decent ranged ability, still hiding in the back. Because they think, hey, I can do damage from all the way in the back, let's hide in the back. It's not a good tactic, guys. All-Stars need to be in the garden. They have a lot of damage. They don't have a lot of health. And the impunt and the auto tackles are abilities solely usable for in the garden. You can do so much damage with an impunt. One impunt can practically clear out an entire garden. So, hiding in the back as an all-star is a bad tactic. Let me rephrase that. Hiding in the back as a zombie is a bad tactic. Let me rephrase that. Hiding in the back, whether you're on the zombie side or on the plant side, is a bad tactic. Get into the garden, guys. Clear out the garden and then push forward. If you're a plant, you kill all the zombies inside the garden. You make sure that all your plants, potable plants, are planted, and then you keep pushing forward. Head toward the teleporter and take down the enemy teleporter and take down anybody you see there. Especially those pesky engineers who want to put up the teleporter again. Take them out first. Now, the same applies if you're playing on the zombie side. Make sure that the engineer is able to put up the teleporter. But if you see that all of the plants are heading for the teleporter and they leave their garden undefended, forget the teleporter. Head for the garden. Punish those stupid plants for leaving their garden undefended. The moment I see that there's nobody in the garden, I'm going to step in there. Even if I am at half health, even if I'm at
Even if I have 1 HP, I'm going into that garden because nobody's defending it. Punish the enemy for making mistakes. Now, as I was about to say, if you're an engineer, if you're playing as the zombies, get to the teleporter as soon as possible. If you can get that up, it'll ensure that your guys can move towards the garden faster, especially if you have all stars on the team. And if the plants are smart, they're going to try to stop you from doing so. But the teleporter comes first. If the teleporter is up, head into the garden. Don't try to fight it out from all the way in the back like most foot soldiers and unfortunately like most new players will do, because chances are that 90% of your team will be made out of foot soldiers who all hide in the back, not pushing forward. That's not how you win the game, guys. You get into the garden. It doesn't matter what character you are, you get into the garden. Now, once you start capturing the garden, once you've killed every plant in there, if you see that there are two zombies in there and you're the third zombie on the scene, push forward. Head beyond the garden. Go into the enemy's defenses. Go into this. Well, I won't say go into the spawns, but keep pushing them back. And I'm not a fan of spawn killing either. I've seen some players do it. It's kind of shitty. I'm not a fan of it, and I don't advise you doing it either. But yeah, keep pushing them back. Make sure that you make it as hard for them to reach the garden. If there are any doorways, put up your dummy shields, put up anything impossible. Put up your sonic mines, make sure that you slow down the enemy from reaching the garden. So that's basically the game, guys. Don't hide in the back, head for the garden, keep pushing the enemy back. Sniping. If you like to snipe, if you like to take the enemy down from a distance, make sure you have enough aggressive players on your team who actually manage to capture the garden. If you do not, stop playing the Gardens and Graveyards mode. Go play Team Vanquish or some other game mode. Because, quite honestly, you won't be helping out your team just by hiding in the back. Anyway, guys, that's my little explanation for, well, explanation, my little roll through for the zombies, guys. In case I didn't make it clear, I did the plants. I explained all of the plants on my Twitch stream last night. So, well, on a Saturday night anyway. So if you're interested, go check out my Twitch stream. It's still archived. The video is still archived over there and you can have a look at it. And yeah, guys, that's basically it. I'm not quite sure how much I will be streaming. I will be streaming from time to time if I can get it. Yeah, I'm still kind of tweaking my settings a bit, trying to get the maximum video quality available for you guys. So I'm still not quite there yet. But once that is done, I'll be streaming a bit more and hopefully I'll see some of you guys over there. Otherwise, keep checking out my YouTube channel. I'll still be putting out a couple of videos a day. And so yeah, if you enjoy PVZ as much as I do, I hope to see you around. Anyway, guys, that's it for this episode. A kind of a long one, I know, but I promised J-Meister I would put up this video. And as I said, I promised, so I should deliver. Anyway, guys, I hope you enjoyed, and I'll see you in the next one. Bye-bye!